Welcome to Talks at GS. I'm Dave Dassey, a partner in the Investment Banking Division. With us today, we have Dale Earnhardt Jr. Many of you, I'm sure, are huge fans. Dale's had an incredibly successful, almost 20-year racing career. Dale retired last year. His memoir is out. It's called Racing to the Finish, My Story. But it's a really honest look at the impact concussions have had on his life and on his career. Dale, why don't we go back and just talk a little bit from the beginning. You talk about your dad, your grandfather. Just what was it like growing up? Was it additive to you in terms of getting more into NASCAR, or were there times where it was more difficult and more troubling?
Certainly, I had my fingers on a lot of advantages, and as long as I took those opportunities, and when I did get the chance to showcase what ability I had, if I was able to do that, then that got people excited. And fortunate enough, I mean, I looked at it at a young age thinking, so there's 40 guys that get to race on Sunday in the NASCAR series, and that's the elite level. So the odds of me being one of those 40 guys, even though I was connected in this awesome lineage, the odds of that really being a reality for me were not very good. So I wasn't always extremely confident. I didn't think in my childhood, oh, I want to be a champion. I just wanted to make a living as a driver. I wanted to pay my bills. I wanted to be able to race as long as I could and afford to do it for a living. And not a lot of people get to do it for a living. A lot of people race, but they also have other jobs and other responsibilities. But it definitely opened tons of doors for me, and I seized on a few of those opportunities and was able to shine when it mattered, and got more and more opportunities as I went down the road and made it all the way to the top level and had some success there.
Maybe talk a little bit about it as you started to race, when you felt like you really had a shot and you really had that gift and the ability to succeed, and then maybe transition a little bit. You had kind of a blowout rookie year when you got on, you won some races, you had just enormous success right when you started.
Absolutely. I was making $350 a week before taxes in 1997, and I raced at a race in Michigan, and I hadn't done anything really up to this point to warrant a real opportunity. And I ran this one race in front of everybody that races, and all my dad's peers, even some of my dad's peers were in the race with me, but my dad was there watching. My dad had never seen me race. For 4 years, I ran locally around, we live in Charlotte, North Carolina, and I'd ran locally in South Carolina, Tennessee. My dad had never seen me run a race for 4 years, but 150 events. So he really didn't know what kind of driver I was, even though maybe he wanted to help me, he still didn't know whether I had real talent. So I'm racing this race in front of him, and we ended up running eighth in this race, which was really good. We had a kind of a borrowed race car and a patchwork crew, a couple buddies, and we drove the car down there in a very small trailer, and we just really were looking at a place. We did great, and it opened my dad's eyes for sure. But I didn't get a job. I didn't get the next break. I was still sort of floundering and looking for that next opportunity, getting, you know, a lot of calling people up, calling owners up and asking them if I could drive the car, and getting turned down right and left. And my dad, in the off season, my dad was looking for a driver, and in the conversation he was having with his best friend, his friend said, you know, you're going to fund this car, you're going to put your own money into this car, why don't you put your son in it? He goes, wow, you really think I should do that? I think you really can drive. Are you sure? And the guy's like, well, you know, you're gonna invest so much of yourself in this, you might as well do it with the family. Well, my dad didn't even tell me about this and didn't tell me I got this job. So I walk into the shop, and it's a month before the race season starts. And I, as far as I'm concerned, I don't have a ride for the next year, and I don't know how I'm gonna, you know, what I'm gonna do to go find a job or where I'm gonna work. And so I walk into the shop to get some tool or something from these guys, and there's my name on the roof of the car. And I thought it was a joke. I was furious because these guys are pranksters, and I thought that this was just a really, really cruel joke. And they were all laughing at me, which made me feel better or feel more sure that it was a joke. And they laughed and laughed and laughed and withheld the truth while they enjoyed what was happening. And finally they came clean and said, "You're the driver." I was like, "Are you sure, really? I'm going to drive next year in this car every week?" And they said, "Yeah." And I was like, "Well, why in the heck does my own dad not tell me this? Like, is this how he hires drivers? You know, is this how he, you know, hired his last driver by surprise?" But I ended up racing in the Xfinity Series, which would be the same as racing in, or playing college football. And so it's right, it's, you know, kind of below the top level in the series. And we won 7 races that year in the championship. And I think in those first couple weeks of racing in that, I mean, I was scared to death because it's now or never. I'm running with a team that's great. I'm full time and I'm gonna flame out or I'm gonna make it. And it was very scary. But within about 3 or 4 weeks, I realized I started to get some traction and confidence and got a couple top 5, top 3, top 2 finishes. Then I won in like my 12th start at Texas Motor Speedway. And it was just, we just went crazy after that. And then my whole life went crazy. We ended up racing in that series for 2 years, won a championship both times, and then moved. We got a phone call from Budweiser, and they wanted to sponsor us in a car in the Cup Elite level. And so I'm standing on stage at the National Sales Convention for Budweiser and Anheuser-Busch as their new Cup driver in a matter of like 24 months. It was crazy. I went from $350 a week with no idea what I was going to do to racing for Budweiser, and you know, the rest is history, I guess.
Talk a little bit about Daytona and winning at Daytona.
Winning at Daytona is the foundation of our sport. It's the most historic racetrack that we have. And my father instilled in me from his actions and his behavior that was the most important race. And he spent 20 years of his career trying to win it. And finally, in 1998, won that race. And it was a big deal for him. And I thought, wow, you know, I'm glad I'm getting this opportunity to race in the Cup Series, but if I have to chase after this one race for 20 years, I don't know how fun that's going to be. Because it was miserable for him, and he came so close so many times. One time he was going into turn 3, last lap, literally less than a half a lap from the checkered flag, and he cut a tire and lost. He'd been leading all day long, just had the race right in his hands. And it seemed like every year something like that would happen. And he just kept saying, "I just guess I'm not supposed to win this race, you know." So this is all sort of imprinting on me. And we finally went there in 2004 in our fifth try and won the race. And the biggest feeling that when you cross the finish line, the biggest feeling you have is relief. You know, the elation and celebration and excitement and all that comes moments later. But that first feeling is relief. The same kind of relief maybe when you get that big break in your profession. You know, you kind of celebrate later, but that moment, the initial moment is like, whew, I don't have to chase this anymore. I have it. And then you go crazy. So it's in NASCAR and what I do, and it's that one day of winning the Daytona 500, that's as good as it gets. And there will never be nothing you do in the sport that gives you that elation, that real pure joy.
Maybe return to Daytona and the tragedy with your father in 2001.
It was a very difficult situation, and it was difficult for the whole sport. You know, somebody told me something, and I don't know if this will make a lot of sense, but someone told me that when I was kind of sitting there thinking, how am I supposed to feel about this? Somebody said that I'll try to make sense of this, it's hard to put into words, but when you lose somebody, your sadness tends to be because you miss them. You miss them, you know, and it's a selfish thing. Like, we want them in our lives. We want them here today. I want this person with me, and it's a selfish reaction. And it's key, I think, to remember that we were lucky to have what we had, lucky to be with them when we were, lucky they were even here for all of us, you know, and all the people's lives that he affected, you know. So I kept telling myself that over and over. I was so lucky that I got to win those two championships that we talked about in an Xfinity series together, because he was in victory lane with me when we did, and I was so lucky to do X, Y, and Z with him and have the relationship that I had with him, because for so long it was not a very close relationship, and then right there toward the end it was just incredible and everything I hoped it would be.
Great. Well, thank you for...
Yeah, no problem. Yeah.
Maybe talk just a little bit about the success, and many people in this room and many people listening have really intense jobs where you need a lot of focus. You spend 3-4 hours on a track going at 200 miles an hour around and around, right next to other cars, sometimes bumping other cars. Just talk a little bit about the focus, the intensity.
Yeah,
sitting in that seat, and I presume you can't relax.
Yeah.
But somehow you can't stay fully tensed out and max adrenaline for multiple hours.
Yeah, it is a bit physical, but it's incredibly mental, and your senses, every sense is at a heightened state, and when you're racing around other cars, you sort of need to know where they are without even looking, and it's a sense, it's a feeling, you use the sound that you're hearing around you, and you use the wind and the way the car feels in the wind. You're going 180 miles an hour and the car sort of buffering around by the wind and the wind off of other cars. If you ever drove down the interstate and got behind an 18-wheeler and you feel it kind of bouncing your car around a little bit and buffering your car, that's the way it feels in a race car. And you use all these senses sort of to feel where cars are around you, and you can make moves and pull and change lanes with total confidence that you're not going to hit someone or spin yourself out or cause a crash. Now, sometimes you're wrong, but sometimes you're wrong. We have spotters in our ear, and this is a guy that's basically on top of the grandstands on the front straightaway, and he's got a radio, and he's talking to you the entire lap, and he's telling you where everybody is. You got a car behind you. You got a car on your right. You got a car on your left. If you're passing, in the motion of passing a car, he'll tell you door, bumper, clear, and that means the car's on your door, the car's on your bumper, and now you're clear. And that spotter is very critical to saving your tail and not only telling you where cars are very close and in close proximity to you, but if there's a crash across the racetrack, he needs to know it. He needs to see it, tell you where it is, tell you to slow down, tell you where to go to miss either the car laying there or debris or whatever's on the racetrack. So the spotter's really critical in a lot of situations like that. But the physical part, there's tracks that are harder than others. We go to Sonoma. It's a road course that has 11 turns. And think about this. If you just drew, most of the racetracks we go to, you turn left, right? It's an oval. You just run left, 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 right? So if you're turning left all the time, you're in this, you get this motion of steering the car, and you use your back to hold yourself up in the seat. There's some G forces every corner trying to pull you out of the seat, and so you use the same muscles all year long. And we go to a road course twice a year, and those 2 weeks you turn right. And I know that sounds so silly, but you're using muscles in your body that you don't use, and you're not used to it. Your muscles certainly aren't ready for it. And those are the toughest races, the road courses. You just physically can't even get to the rental car, almost can't even walk to the rental car. You're so wore out. But the physical part of it is the worst. It drains you mentally. And there's a 600 mile event, and most of our races are 500 miles and less. That 600 mile event is, you can tell that even those last 100 miles come, your body's not conditioned for that extra 100 miles, and you can tell right away, like you're falling off a cliff as far as your ability to focus and stay in the moment and keep that concentration level at its peak. And that's the moment when you need it the most, because the checkered flag's coming. And so in that one race where you don't, you're going that extra 100 miles and your body's not kind of conditioned to it, you can really find yourself in some trouble.
Maybe now transition to, I believe it was August 29th in 2012, where you first realized officially you had suffered a pretty severe concussion, and start to just talk about the evolution of the concussions, the awareness.
That's right. In 2000,
how you struggled with it.
I'd had a few concussions in racing, par for the course. Hit something real hard, you're kind of going to have some injuries. But the culture in the sport at that point had really been just that, you know, it was a bit of a badge of honor. You laugh about it with your team or your buddies, and by the next race you were fine and back on the racetrack and not even thinking about it. In 2012, I hit. We were at a test at Kansas, and it was a newly paved track, and it was extremely fast. And we were going about 210 miles an hour, and the right front tire blew, and I hit the wall at about 180 miles an hour at a 30-degree angle, and it was just a tremendous impact. And I knew as I was coming to the fence, like there's a split second where it seems to slow down, and you get to think about it way too much. And I was like, "This is really going to hurt. This is going." I just was so in awe of what was about to happen. And it hits the wall, and it's just so violent, and the car, you know, just kind of slides across or along the fence for about 300 yards and comes to a stop. I get out, kind of do the check of everything. Everything's in one piece and nothing's broken. And another driver, Brad Keselowski, who I race with, drove. He heard it. He heard the crash. Didn't see it. Said it sounded like an airplane exploded. And he comes driving up in his rental car, and he's like, "You know, you okay?" And I was like, "Yeah, I think so." And we get in the rental car, and I go back to the garage, and I get out. And by that point, I'm starting to feel some problems, you know, and some real unusual symptoms. And I just couldn't plug into my surroundings. I was really kind of confused as to what was, where I was, or who I was talking to, or it's really hard to explain, but you're in, it's like shell shock, if you can imagine maybe what it would be like for a bomb to go off near you and how that might stun you. And I was in that constant state for a long time and getting more and more into that state, you know, kind of like spiraling down. And as all this was happening, I was getting this really severe cases of nausea. And it wouldn't go away, you know, how nausea kind of comes and goes. And this was just getting more and more severe by the second. And all I wanted to do was lay down, just get horizontal. And so I'm freaking out. And my wife came. We were supposed to go to a Monday night football game in Washington, D.C. And so she had came to the test to leave with me after it was over, and I was telling her, I'm like, "Something's bad wrong with me. I don't know what it is and what to do, but I got a real problem." And I decided to push through. We went to that game, and I went to this Washington Redskins game and sat in the owner's box with Dan Snyder, and I did some TV, all completely blitzed out of my head. And I went to the racetrack and ran the next week feeling bad. Sick, and I went and did that for about 3 weeks, and I finally started feeling better, and we ran another race at Talladega. Feeling good, thinking I'm in the clear, and going to put this behind me, going to be fine, and we crashed again at Talladega. Talladega, it was a big crash, about 15, 20 cars in this wreck, and I just happened to get hit real hard, and all the symptoms came right back, just like this light switch. It just was overwhelming, and my emotions were, I couldn't control my emotions. My anger was raging, and I'm really a very low, easy going, calm person, and I couldn't control how angry I was. It was really an odd experience. And I told my wife again, I said, "I got a real problem here." And so we ended up going seeing a neurosurgeon in Charlotte, and his name is Dr. Petty. And he connected me with a guy named Mickey Collins, who works with the Pittsburgh Steelers and the Penguins, the NHL team up there. And he saw me, and he fixed it. It took about 2 weeks. I had to quit racing for a couple weeks, and he fixed the problem. And I'm like, "Yeah, you know, Mickey Collins fixed me. Boy, I'm just telling everybody all about it and go back to the racetrack." And this is 2012. So keep on racing. And I started wrecking again in 2013, 2014. I didn't want to go back to the doctor. I didn't want to stop racing. I didn't want anybody to know. And I started taking a journal and writing in this journal about every crash. And I did this repeatedly over and over and over again all the way through 2016. So I went back to Dr. Petty and he diagnosed me with a concussion. I would never would have thought it was a concussion because you usually tie a concussion to an immediate event, like bam, you hit something concussed. Well, this came on like the flu, like out of nowhere. And so I immediately was sent up to see Mickey Collins again, and he's like, man, I showed him the notes and all the crashes and the years of trying to, you know, document this and take care of it myself, and he's like so mad at me. And he was really angry, and everybody that was learning all this for the first time, I'd hid these notes from my wife, my sister, who was my business manager as well, and everybody that I knew. No one knew this. And so everyone was angry. Anyways, the symptoms were super severe, and I was out of the car for about 6 months. I completely lost the second half of the 2016 season. And it was embarrassing that I'd put myself in that situation. I'd made so many stupid, foolish mistakes, all the while touting what Mickey had done in 2012. So the whole time, I'm not only keeping this all a secret, but I'm a hypocrite because I'm telling people how they should act and how they should handle concussions, but I wasn't doing it myself. And so, anyways, Mickey fixed it again. He gave me the tools that I needed, and it was a lot more robust, obviously, to get through this one, this issue. It took about 3.5-4 months for the symptoms to go away instead of 2 weeks. And it was very, very frightening. And there was a period of time in the middle of it where I didn't think it was ever gonna go away, you know? And I thought, I'm gonna wake up every day the rest of my life with these symptoms, and I don't know how I'm gonna live that way. I just don't know how I could live that way. And without the support of my wife, Amy, I would have gave up. I would have quit doing the exercises. I would have spiraled into a dark, dark hole. And luckily, she was there every morning when I didn't want to get out of bed. The exercises I had to do were about 3 hours every single day and for 5 months. And I got tired of it. And I would have probably gave up and just quit and settled for, you know, 50%. Of rehabilitation, but she wouldn't settle, and she wouldn't let me settle, and she wanted me back, she wanted our lives back, and she didn't care whether I raced or not. And so she worked really hard, pushed me really hard, and I knew as soon as I got well, I would forget. That's the way I felt. You know, I would get well and go, I think I can do it. I think I can get in the car and do it one more time. I had 1 year left on my contract, and I wasn't going to be okay with this injury sidelining my life this way. And so I talked to Mickey and I said, hey, Mickey, you know, I've been telling you for 4 months I want to quit racing. And you're like, yeah, I got, you know, I back your decision. Well, I've changed my mind. I want to race. What do you think? And he said, I back that decision. And so then I got a little upset because Mickey is a guy that shuts down athletes. You know, he's had to tell 20-something-year-old football players that they can no longer play the game. They have to understand that they're not going to be able to get this million-dollar contract and this guarantee. And he's had to tell them, like, you're done playing. And I was so mad. I was like, Mickey, why won't you just tell me I'm done? I want you to do it. I want you to tell me that I shouldn't race anymore, and that's your recommendation to never drive, and you're going to tell NASCAR not to let me back in the car. And he goes, I don't see any reason to do that. I think that what you have, I've helped you get over, and I think that you can go back and compete. I don't think you're at danger to get injured again, no more than you were before you were hurt, or no more than any other driver on the track. I ended up deciding to go back and try to make it through one final season and be able to get to the end of that year and close the book on, no pun intended, on my own terms. And so I was able to do that. I was real grateful that I was able to stay healthy that season. And when I got done, so the reason for this book is all along the way, since 2012, all the way up to this process, or to this day, even today, I talked to Mickey, and he'll tell me, I saw two people last week that told me they read an article that you spoke about your issues, and that's why they're here. they just like me, they didn't know where to go, don't know where to go, don't know that this treatment's available, because this treatment that Mickey gave me wasn't around 5 years ago. What he treated me with in 2012 was to lock me in a closed room with the lights off, no TV, no cell phone, you know, the old adage, just shut everything down and don't do anything and it'll get well. Well, that was how they treated me in 2012. In 2016, what they learned by that point, just 4 years later, was to expose the brain and challenge the brain and stretch it like a muscle. So I would push myself to go to real complex environments like concerts, the grocery store, anywhere that was busy and noisy and crazy, to make myself sort of flare those symptoms up, really get them symptoms going crazy, and then back out of that area and calm back down, and then an hour later go back in and keep on retraining the brain to handle that experience. And so that's how, that was part of the rehab. So just think about how much has changed in that four-year period and how much has changed since then. So I'm really I was really excited once I got done racing and got that final year finished and I was able to enjoy it to write this book.
Well, Dale, thank you very much for spending an hour with us. It was very enlightening and appreciate
you. Yeah, I enjoyed it. All right, thank you.